Thanksgiving in our hearts and with a song of joy upon our lips, or at least that is our desire. Yet if we are to be truly honest this day, none of us are entirely ready for this time of worship. Not one of us is filled only with joy and knows nothing but hope and peace. Among this gathered community, there are lives bruised by tragedy and loss. There are those who carry the weight of rejection and loneliness. Yet despite the baggage we carried into the space, your love welcomed us. In fact, we believe that you are absolutely thrilled that we are showed up just as we are. Life, our prayer this day, and align us more completely in your grace and mercy. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Today, we are going to celebrate All Saints' Day with this special service of remembrance. This is a time in which we remember all the saints who have lost their lives over the last year. As your loved one's name is shared, you are invited to come forward and get a flower from either Cynthia or Sherry and place it in one of the vases here at the stage. A single bell will toll following each of the names, giving us a moment to reflect on their lives and their memories. At the end of this worship service, you are invited to take a flower or two and take them home with you to remember your loved ones. Let us begin our time of worship.
There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you.
Turn on me.
You turn morning to dancing. You turn beauty to ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn ways into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highlands. You're the
of remembrance with member George Tinkin. Dorothy Alexa. Lois Froge. B. Pentler. Earl Pentler. Gary Cowley. Member Ruth Bates. Sandy Murray. Jose Ramirez. Member Tom Brandt. Member Mary Brandt. Charles Brady. Member Helen Cantrell. Jack De La Garza. Member John Cooksey. Jack Logan. Bob Quance. Member Roxy McDonald. David Saborn. Member Frank Stack. Ted Meredith. Member Paul Siverson. Member Bitsy Siverson. Debbie Barlow. Marcella Garcia. Mary Perrin. Robert Hardy Sr. Casey Russell. Louise Peterson. Lonnie Friend. And last but not least, Randy Friend. Will you join me in prayer? O gracious God, creator of heaven and earth, we lift up this day for all of your servants and witnesses that have gone before us over this last year. We gather to remember and celebrate those who we have loved with this All Saints Day ceremony of recognition. Lord, we thank you for all of these saints who have left a lasting touch on our lives. Enable us to live love-first lives through the examples we have seen in the lives of all of these saints. It is in Jesus' precious name that we pray. Amen.
Cypress Creek Christian Church. On this day, we recognize All Saints Day, All Souls Day. My name is James Seymour, and I'm one of the elders here, and I just want to extend a welcome to all of our visitors, and if you're not a visitor, we're glad to have you back. First thing, is there a picture, Angela? There is a baby. So, everybody welcome Carter Dwight Tiffany. The name was not Obadiah, all of you who kept calling him that. So that's our good news for right now. Next, there is a sign up for Advent where Bruce is going to be doing a study at 1:30. It will be recorded and you can watch it later. There's a book up there. I'm assuming Bruce will say more about this later, but you should do the Advent study. And finally, Bruce is sending out a survey on anti-racism and pro-reconciliation. We need your input on this in person before November 5th. Oh, wait a minute. That's today. So you all better get on the ball with this and get this moving. or there's going to be a homework for you all today. And now I'm going to read you the scripture for today, which is coming from Psalm 30. When I was comfortable, I said, I will never stumble. But it pleased you, Lord. You made me a strong mountain. But then you hid your presence. I was terrified. I cried out to you, Lord. I begged my Lord for mercy. What is to be gained by my spilled blood, by my going down into the pit? Does dust thank you? Does it proclaim your faithfulness? Lord, listen and have mercy on me. Lord, be my helper. You changed my mourning into dancing. You took off my funeral clothes and dressed me up in joy, so that my whole being might sing praises to you and never stop. Lord, my God, I will give thanks to you forever. Here ends the reading.
Carry on. in church. I know that for many of you, this has been a very rich, powerful, hard moment. There is something about this All Saints Sunday, and I think it's important to recognize it in that song. Thank you for doing that. It's just a powerful song in a moment like this. If you are a guest with us, we're glad that you're here. I want to say welcome to all of you, but extend a special welcome to guests or visitors. Cypress Creek Christian Church is a community striving to put love first in all things. We recognize that that does not come naturally to most of us. Some of us hope love hits the top three on a regular basis. But there's something about coming together for worship. There's something about having somebody pray for you. There's something about fellowshipping with others that begins to build our capacity to reach for love a little more often. And that is our hope. I want to invite our young disciples that are worshiping with us. I think Carolina and Marianne are going to be with you this morning. We are thankful for your presence here today. And as they're headed out, I'm going to invite the rest of you to kind of quiet your minds and your hearts and let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, we have heard names. We have shared in song. We have seen images. All of it is so evocative and powerful. We pray that in the midst of all of it, that we also recognize you walking alongside us in this time of worship and in every moment of life. We offer these prayers in the name of Christ. Amen. Last Sunday, I started this new series about self-care. As some of you have heard, I did it in part just to preach it to myself. But I have a feeling there may be two or three of you that also need to hear this series, not so good at self-care. An insurance agent got a phone call, somebody looking for a quote, insurance on his car. The insurance agent asked, make, model, background, got a little history of the driver. He said, can I buy it monthly? Yes, you can, but we'll get to that when I give you the quote. Later that day, the insurance agent got back with the man, gave him the amount. He said, great, I wanted that low deductible. That's perfect. I'll give you my credit card. But where do I take my car? He asked the insurance agent. Oh, you don't have to bring in your car. I trust you. No. Where do I take it to get fixed? Yes, he had had an accident 2 days earlier. You may be surprised, but insurance agents say they get that call on a regular basis. I'm pretty sure that's not how insurance works. A lot of things in life do not work that way. Most things, they may not require you to prepay, but they require preparation, putting certain things in place. Maybe relationship building, intentionality, being deliberate in advance of whatever it is. Yet there are some of us, and maybe I should just speak about myself here, who are really good at procrastination. But there's a point, if you have procrastinated enough, there is nothing you can do because you've missed the window. You missed the opportunity to put things in place. One of my closest friends for years, his name is David. David died a little over a decade ago. David had two events in life that changed everything for him. The first one was his daughter, Lily, at age 2, was diagnosed with something called Rett syndrome. It is a devastating neurological disease that ended up being the cause of her death at age 15. A short time after that, David was diagnosed with a very rare form of cancer. About 6 months before David died, I flew up there to be with him. And it was during that visit that David, who also was a minister, talked about this realization of the amazing community of people that he had around him. He said it with both awe, but also implied that somehow he was not deserving of such friendship and support and care. It was another friend that was seated with us that day who spoke up and said, "This doesn't just happen, though. Those relationships, David, were built over time, in part because of what you did and because of what you were willing to do." He was absolutely right. David and I had known each other since I was a senior in high school. He had walked alongside me through some really challenging moments in my own life. But I did not get on the plane to go visit him because I thought, "Oh, well, I owe him for this." Not at all. It was about the relationship that we had built. I needed to be there, yes, for him, but also for me. Because that's what people do who deeply care for one another. But you do not create those relationships after the crisis has occurred. After Hurricane Harvey, we put floodgates over there in front of the Centrum. As the hurricane was approaching, we didn't say to ourselves, "You know, we should put some floodgates in." Or as the water was coming down and the creek was rising, we didn't say, "You know, maybe we can run over there and put some floodgates." It was something that took a lot of work and preparation after the flood. We put them in hoping that we would never again have to use them. But in light of what had occurred, we saw it as something that we should do now and not wait. Now, I do not want to imply in this sermon this morning that we create good relationships so that we can get something out of it. No, we create good relationships and friendships because it is good self-care. And when you've done the work to build those relationships, especially over time, then if something happens, should I say when something happens, because of the life that you have lived together, people will be there, not out of obligation, but out of love. I find Psalm 30 that you heard read just to be fascinating. The author suggests that at one time life was really, really good. No problems, very comfortable, never stumbled. Sounds pretty nice to me. The author also suggests that somehow all this good stuff was because God liked him. And then something happens in the middle of the psalm. Something bad. We don't know the details, but something occurs. Maybe it is kind of implied that it's punishment. And finally, when the author cries out to God and God hears the cries, God makes everything right again. That theology, the theology of this psalm, is birthed out of what's known as kind of this ancient wisdom tradition. And in that tradition, there was something called cause-effect ethics. If you're good, God gives you good stuff. If you're bad, God gives you only bad stuff. It sounds great, but it makes God into a giant gum machine. I put in this, I expect to get something out of it. But starting with the book of Job, and then in some of the prophets, and definitely within the teachings and ministry of Jesus, that kind of thinking is slowly dismantled. I think what we take away is, in part, life happens. Sometimes we can point directly to a cause, and other times it's a mystery. We simply do not know. But I do not believe that faith is about getting God on our side, hoping to tip the scales with enough good stuff so more good stuff will pour on us. It's about seeking a relationship with God. Shall I say, a friendship with God. That over time, we come to trust that God will walk with us, no matter what is happening, like a good friend. That God's presence will be there in the good and in the bad, in the mediocre and every other time as well. But again, it's important to not wait. I'm not saying a relationship can't start in the midst of a crisis, but it's a whole lot easier if you've done some of the work in advance. And you come to believe that God's there, the crisis happens, and you go, I don't like this, but I know I'm not alone. My parents moved from Lincoln, Nebraska to Milwaukee, Wisconsin before I was born. They moved there because my father was taking a position at the University of Wisconsin there in Milwaukee in the education department. I was born shortly thereafter, the fourth child to Bob and Lois. But less than 2 years after I was born, my father died of a brain aneurysm. In the short time that they had been in Milwaukee, my mother had created some wonderful friendships. But she made the choice to move back to Lincoln, Nebraska. That was the place where she and my dad met. It's where they'd gone to college together. They had started their life together. And they had been a part of a Sunday school class at First Christian Church in Lincoln, Nebraska. And the relationships that they had built in that class, both during college and in the post-college years, were deeply grounded. And many years later, after my mother retired, I remember talking to her about those months after my father's death and her decision to move back to Lincoln. For her, it wasn't a tough decision. The people in Milwaukee were amazing, but there was something about that group of friends that she needed. It was interesting to me that in the last 2-3 years of my mother's life, some of the children of those very people that had been longtime friends with my mother, their children came to visit my mother. They kind of thought of her as family. Some of them even were confused and thought she was part of the family. But she wasn't. Relationships require time and energy. They require us to be proactive in the creation of them. And like our relationship with God, our friendships are not about what we will get out of them. We are not creating leverage. They are not transactional. I'll do 2 good things for you, so you know you're going to be required to do at least 2 good things for me. I think God created us to live in relationship. I think the image of, whether it's the Trinitarian language that we find in the New Testament or the language that we find in the Genesis creation story where God says, let us create them in our image. There is a plural there. There is plurality to God. God is already in relationship. And I think part of the image that God puts upon creation is for us to live in relationship together. Jesus told anyone who would listen to love. Sometimes he made very dramatic proclamations about loving everyone. Because everyone carries the image of God. Everyone is deserving of love. Whether you agree with them or not, whether you like them or not, you're supposed to love. But at times he would also say to a more intimate group, love one another. And it wasn't to create some sort of elite group. We're just the insiders here. But there's a recognition about the importance of being in those kinds of relationships together. Over the years, I've done a number of weddings for couples, late 20s, maybe early 30s. When I work with a couple, I take them through what's called a pre-marriage inventory. It's not a test, but it's a look at strengths and weaknesses within their relationship. And a section of it has to do about your faith background, especially if people are coming from very different faith backgrounds. How well have you talked about this? What are you thinking? But a number of times I've had couples say, oh, you know, we grew up going to Sunday school, but we don't go to church now. Maybe it'll be something we'll do someday, but you know, right now we're focused more on ourselves, maybe doing some traveling, and we're kind of thinking that, you know, want to focus on our career. But someday, yeah, we'll get back to church. Handful of times, sometimes 10, 12, 15 years after doing a wedding, I get a phone call. I'm shocked that they still have my number. But something's happened. Someone's in the hospital, a diagnosis. Will I come? And I have in time, and I don't ask it in kind of a rude way, but you know, who else do you have? And two times I've had people say, oh, we have friends, but they're not that kind of friend. Not come and visit us at the hospital kind of friend. The system, the structure, was not put in place in advance. And I'm not suggesting you go, well, maybe someday I want to go to the hospital, I want somebody to come and visit me. But there is something about deep and abiding relationships that are life-giving in all aspects of life. Maybe you will be the one that will show up in that hospital room in a time of need because you know this person and because you wouldn't be anywhere else. In one of my daily etchings this past week, I mentioned a Lutheran minister by the name of Michael Foss. He wrote a book a number of years ago, Six Marks of Discipleship for Changing a Church. Actually, that was a subtitle. Power Surge was the main title of the book. In the book, he tells a story about starting as the senior minister of a new church. First week that he had been there. As he's walking out, second, third day, somebody says, oh, you know, so-and-so's having surgery the next morning. Oh, okay, I'll plan to go visit. So he set his alarm a little extra early, got up the next morning, put on his collar, as a good Lutheran minister does, jumped in the car, drove to the hospital, found what room she was in, waiting for surgery, went to the room, knocked on the door. The door opened, and the woman waiting for surgery's lying there in the bed, but there were five other women in the room. They look at him a little surprised. Oh, Pastor Michael, we're glad you're here. Why? I thought I'd come and pray. Oh, they said, those other five women were a part of a longtime care group and Bible study. They'd all been together. But at that moment, the five women get up and leave the room to leave Michael to do, as he said, somewhat sarcastically, to do my professional work. He had a prayer with her. But as he was driving home from the hospital, he kind of had this realization that he, in fact, had interrupted something very powerful. These were the people who knew this woman's story, knew her history, knew what it was that was causing her maybe fear or conflict in that moment. And he walked in as the professional to do the professional thing, when in fact what needed to be happening in that room was already because they had built relationships over time. Saint Teresa of Avila, a 16th century mystic, wrote this: what a great favor God does to those whom God places in the company of good people. And in the book of Sirach, an apocalyptic book, it says this: trustworthy friends are a strong shelter. Whoever finds one has found a treasure. Trustworthy friends have no price, and no one can estimate their worth. Trustworthy friends are life's medicine. I love that language. And those who are humble before the Lord will find them. One of the priorities for Cypress Creek Christian Church in 2024 is to create more opportunities for us to connect. Whether that is in a Sunday school setting or in a small group setting. We have some that already exist that are amazing. But to recognize how important it is to create relationships, to create friendships in the life of the church. And we don't do it because, you know, I want to build up some, you know, a little extra so that when I need something, I can call upon. There's something life-giving about having a friend. And they say right now, perhaps the most significant health issue facing people today in America is loneliness. Solving that is kind of what we do. but we need to be intentional about the work. And we need to make sure that we are creating space for people to find a friend. You join me in a word of prayer. There's a lot of work to be done, always in the life of your church. But God, we pray this day for new opportunities to arise, new possibilities for people to come together, to grow together, to connect anew. We are thankful, God, for the way that you do bring us together in and through your love, for the way that the relationship that you are calling us to have with you is a model for the relationship we are to have with one another. You are not loving us because you want us to do certain things, and only if we do those things will you really love us. You call us into a relationship of unconditional, limitless love. And out of that experience, we want to experience it more. We want to embody it. And so we pray for your help, for your encouragement in that endeavor. We offer our words in the name of Christ Jesus. Amen. In my Sunday school class this morning, we were talking about the ancient practice in the Jewish temple and how Christians have misinterpreted, misunderstood what happened there. You know, okay, I did something bad. I got to take in this lamb, have it sacrificed. Maybe God will forgive me. Well, the practice was a powerful ritual when it was done at its best. I recognized something in my life, man, that really was not good. My relationship with God, I feel as if I've kind of injured that relationship. I take a gift. Your spouse, your significant other, you do something, wasn't great. What do? Sometimes you show up with a gift. A way of saying, yeah, I recognize that I messed up. And they took it to the temple and they would carve out the entrails and some other stuff. And they would mostly burn up the stuff that wasn't really great. And if the smoke went up, it was a sign that God was receiving your offering. Well, what direction does smoke go? It wasn't like they were playing a game, wondering. No, it was part of a ritual. They knew that God would receive that offering. And then they would take a portion of the meat. Some of it would go to the priests and the system. But some of it would go to a room where you would have a meal with your family and with God. Because you would eat with people that you were reconciled to. That's sort of what we do here at the table. You don't have to bring a goat or a pigeon or anything else. Just come as you are. I wouldn't even know what to do with those. But come as you are. And know that this meal will remind you that all is good. Because God's love is eternal. Maybe there's something to work on. I got some stuff to work on. But there's something about being at this table of acceptance and goodness and grace that gives me the capacity to do that needed work. Let us prepare for a time here at the table. If you've never participated in communion here at Cypress Creek, a couple different ways you can take it. There is some unleavened bread here. You can take a piece, dip it in the cup, and partake of the elements. There are little communion in one. If you're needing gluten-free, it says it right there on the top. You can partake of it that way. And if you wish to share an offering, there are baskets in the back as well as little boxes in the back of the sanctuary. God's love invites you to come to this table. And know that that love is unconditional, it is limitless, and it is relentless in its pursuit of us to be in relationship with God and to learn how to be in even more powerful and intimate relationships with one another. Let us prepare. Thank you.
Thanksgiving, the saving acts and presence of Christ. Here at Cypress Creek Christian Church, we want to remind you that all believers are welcome to come and participate, regardless of your age, religious tradition, or the condition of your spirit. The Last Supper reminds us that we are all forgiven and part of the family of Christ. Echoing the Passover feast, Jesus took on the night when he was betrayed a loaf of ordinary bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took a cup and said, "This is the cup of the new covenant of my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us pray.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this sanctuary where we come together at this table. Today, we honor all saints and families who may be grieving. Many times, we prepare our lives and unexpected circumstances come our way. This table brings us hope in our lives, finding comfort in our daily journey. Lord, we thank you for the greatest prayer your Son taught us. Our Father,
Lord in heaven, hallowed be
The table is prepared. Please come.
Thank you.
bring my notes this morning because there are a number of announcements I want to lift up and my brain can't remember all of them, so need a little help. I do want to remind the elders, and for those of you new to Cypress Creek, when we say elders, we're not talking about the elderly. We are talking about a group of folks that are known as kind of as the spiritual leaders in the life of the church. An elder can be of any age. And I'm thankful for that group that is very intentional about praying in the life of the community. They have care groups that they specifically lift up in prayer or contact in a time of need. So we're meeting immediately after worship, though we're meeting over in the youth building, the education building, because, no we're not, I think we're meeting over across the way in the bride's room. Follow the elders. But you maybe have noticed that things, maybe see tape on the ground, they're getting ready for an event that I'm going to talk about here in a minute. One of the things we do here around Cypress Creek is the NAM Christmas bags. See a car full of them from a couple years ago, taking them back to NAM. We asked for about 80 bags for the congregation. They gave us 100. So we're being challenged this year. Last year we estimated that we probably purchased about $7,500 worth of gifts. And that is really quite extraordinary. Also, want to lift up what I was talking about in regard to the tape on the ground and different things around is the Dickens Market. Starting immediately after worship, they're going to be setting things up for the Dickens Market, and there are booths in every space. And so I hope you'll come and be supportive of that. It's on Friday and Saturday. There are literally thousands of people that will come through our buildings. And then looking ahead a few weeks, we always participate in the Spring Interfaith Thanksgiving service. In fact, we hosted it last year. It is the Thursday before Thanksgiving. This year, it's going to be at the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints on Kleinwood Drive. Starts about 6:30. There are all kinds of traditions that are going to be participating in it, and it is always a very meaningful experience. So I hope you will come and participate. Then ahead to December the 5th, December 3rd, Christmas concert in the Centrum. That is both the traditional choir and the chorale. It is always a wonderful, wonderful event. And then real quickly, we have, since the church's existence, always taken up what's called the annual reconciliation offering. It supports the work of being an anti-racist, pro-reconciling tradition. We received a grant this year, and we already have a Sunday school class that is working on that, but they're wanting to expand. So there's a survey in highlights this past week, and you could link to it. Next week, they'll have opportunities for you to take the survey here. And it's just an opportunity to kind of measure our readiness for that and maybe some areas where we can work, both in the short term and in the long term. So I will encourage you to do that. Two other things. I was going to ask if we had a picture of the baptism. I did a baptism over at the traditional service 45 minutes, an hour ago. And Mackenzie Frazier, it was a joy to bring her into the waters of baptism. And I always say to folks, we'll fill that baptistry up anytime if there's somebody that would like to seek baptism. And then, as you all, I think, already heard, we celebrate Carter's entrance into this world, Mariah and Evan's new child. I did get a text message from her earlier saying they're going to get to go home today. And so we just pray for them. But I remind you that she is on parental leave. So if you have a question that you would usually ask Mariah, don't ask Mariah. Call the church office. Give them some space so that they can just be family. As we do every Sunday, we extend an invitation. It is an invitation to anyone who is seeking to have a question answered about Cypress Creek. Maybe you're looking for just somebody who will pray with you. Or maybe you are wanting to partner, to connect with this congregation, or just ask what that's all about. Well, we are hoping that we are going to have the wells here soon. We're calling it Meet Us at the Well, but we're still waiting for the wells to show up. But they will be there will be a well, a literal well on wheels, but it will be out here in the foyer. But you'll have to just look for me today. And if you would like to come and to seek prayer, seek more information. You can do that. I know you can also talk to James, you can talk to Esau. There are others in the life of our congregation that will gladly answer those questions. Now I'm going to invite you to rise, whether that is in body, spirit, or both, as we join together in our song of discipleship. Closing prayer that you see on the screen. There it is. Gracious God,